Okay, hi everyone, my name is Lahir, and here I've got Andrew, and we're just going to discuss why would you have lower FiO2 in really unhealthy lungs. And so the question I'm posing to Andrew here is, you know, say you've got someone with really bad lungs, maybe they've got an evolving pneumonia, maybe they've just had a recent aspiration or evolving bronchospasm. Now, I'm going to make the argument that if you have this case and they rush to theatre, in this case, you might actually want to have a low FiO2. So let's try to explore that. So, good. So, first of all, I'm just going to draw you some pretty dodgy looking lungs here. Imagine that these lungs are a little bit bad, but they could get worse. Now, there's going to be two situations. Let's say you've got a FiO2. So that's FiO2 and SATS in scenario 1 and scenario 2. Do we have to get that? Then I've got time. 1, 2, these are just arbitrary numbers here. Now, if I start with a low FI, let's say 40%, and the SATS are not great but they're okay, 94%, versus FiO2 of say 80%. SATs are still about 90% because the lungs are equally as bad. Now, so I'll ask you, Andrew, what happens to the SATs in this situation and this situation if the lungs get a little bit worse? So there's like an evolving pneumonia, there's an evolving bronchospasm or whatever it is. Now, what happens in, you know, say 2 minutes, 10 minutes, whatever it is, as the lungs get a little bit worse? What happens here, do you reckon?
So we expect the SATs here are going to go down.
Fantastic. So the SATs will say 90%? What does the SATs over here?
Probably, they might go down a little bit, but probably not much. Probably stay around 94.
People feel the same. Now, let's see, the lungs get a little bit worse. What happens as time moves on?
So again, these will go down.
Yep, let's say more. 100%. Obviously, we're going to intervene then.
Here and on this side, it might go down, but it might stay the same.
Beautiful. Because you've got a lot of reserve, you can might stay the same and keep going. So let's say they go to 80%, and then SATs might at this point just go down a little bit, and then here, let's say 75%, and now they finally go down to somewhere that I'm really concerned about. So that's as the evolving process gets worse and worse, my lungs get worse, and suddenly my SATs are dropping in these two situations. And what's interesting is, Andrew, when would you, if you had the SATs on 80%, when would you start treating this problem?
So early, around here for this one.
Yeah, for this one. So FiO2 40%, at time 2, as soon as it drops, suddenly you start treating. So you'd increase your FiO2, you'd have lots of time, because now I've, you know, put my FiO2 straight to 100%. And I'll have, you know, say 5-10 minutes before the lungs get really worse, and I'll start treating straight away. But I'll identify it at this point here, at time 2. If I've got my SATs 80%, yeah, where do you start intervening?
Yeah.
So if my SATs are too high, that means I start intervening here, which is really bad, right? Because now I have no room to move. Even if I increase my SATs 100%, I don't have 10 minutes. I've only got a couple of minutes to sort my things out and solve the problem. So that's my argument. So if I have my FiO2 lower in sick lungs, but still keeping the patient safe, you know, so they've got a 94% SATs or above, that enables me to really have to identify when there's a problem, increase the FiO2, and have lots of time to solve that problem. Now, this also makes sense because of the HbO2 dissociation curve. That's the SATs on that axis, the PO2 on that axis. And this curve here looks a little bit like this. If I'm running at high FiO2, so high PO2, if the patient's there and the lung deteriorate, the SATs don't drop. Because we're not measuring the AVGs constantly, we're not able to see that the PO2 is actually dropping. And in this situation here, it drops and drops and drops until finally we see a drop, but that's when we've got very little reserve. In this situation here, I'm running the patient just at the cusp of, you know, over here, and so as soon as something goes wrong, I see a noticeable change. So that's my argument for why we should run lower FIs in sick lungs, so that we identify exactly when the problem's going to occur. Now, this is an anaesthetic context, obviously not an ICU context or other contexts like in the ward, very specific context, but yeah, that's my argument for that.